I'm back with part two of the movie Breakdown of Soul Food. And for those who haven't done it yet, make sure that you hit that subscribe button and that notification bell. I'm going to give y'all a few seconds to do that.
Curry sets fire, puts it up. Bang! Steph Curry from way downtown.
Welcome to the Juice Bar.
This is the place to be.
So Bird found out that Lim ain't got a job, and so she ended up calling up her ex to pull a favor for her. And let's just look at this conversation go. I mean, just look at the smile on her face.
I knew you'd call.
See me well. Let me take your briefcase, baby. Come on over here.
Dad, you treat me all good. What's going on?
Actually, I need a favor.
But what's in this for me?
Bird was out of control on so many different levels. For one, even contacting her ex to put her husband in a situation. For two, just her behavior towards him, like she was all feminine and bigging him up. And then he asked, like, hey, what was in it for him? And to me, I think she had to do something that was gonna break her vows. Hey, but let's keep it moving. Then when Bird's husband come home, she already getting a stay set for him, so like, cause she already knew the results. But let's listen to their conversation.
Found a gig.
Kenny called me yesterday and told me to ask about a job at the biggest in-house printing company in town. They didn't even know who the hell Kenny Simmons was.
Liam should have sat around and thought that out, because it don't make sense. You get a call from Kenny about the biggest print company in the area. You go down there, you take Kenny Sense, you don't even know who Kenny is. Like, you should like, hey, what's going on? Something strange going on. That should have been a red flag to him. But then Bird reaction, like Bird, she just went along. She played along. Like, she ain't know what was going on. But we all know she did something wrong. But moving right along. Then while Lim was at the job, Bird ex come up to Lim and let him know that he the one who got him the job, and that him and Bird had history. Next thing you know, Lim was putting hands on him and ended up getting fired. Then Lim head down to Bird's shop to check on that situation, but he do get out of control. But look at her response too.
Think I'm not man enough to find my own job?
Sorry.
What the fuck you have to do for him then, huh? Ain't no man gonna give you a motherfucking thing free.
I didn't do nothing with him. I just told him that I was gonna go to dinner with him, and that is it.
You lying ass.
I don't think he did all that for just some dinner. I think it was more to it. Now she over here throwing up. Then Terry called their cousin to put hands on Lim. Their cousin called Lim at the bar, but the surprise was on him and his homies. Take a look. That incident led to Lim getting locked up. Then we move to Faith and Miles, and these two have been spending a lot of time together. And you can tell by the smile on Miles' face, he clearly enjoying the company. And Faith enjoying his company as well. Look, she laughing at his lame jokes. Then Faith walk up into his studio because she hot off the chemistry. She hot off the connection. Then he looking all shocked like, bro, you know what time it is. Stop playing. Then one thing lead to another, and now we here. Yeah, we right here. But then Miles start making love, and in this situation, I thought he'd really be trying to cut. Here, let's take a look.
You give me something to love.
Then Terry came home and seen him, and then she ended up leaving the house. Now Miles looking all goofy at the words, like, bro, you just hit. And Faith saw it because she wanted the disaster special. You know, she wanted the furniture all on the floor. She wanted the glass broken, but that ain't happened. You know what I'm saying? He made love to her.
A few hours later.
Then everybody had linked up over Maxine and Kenny house to celebrate their anniversary. Terry still sorry about what she saw a few hours ago. But Faith having a good old time. Hey, let's check her out. Then Terry come from the back to survey the scene, and she see everybody all booed up, and then she take a look at Miles, and he looking all sad and relaxed. And then this is when the movie became a horror film, with Terry being the villain. Then the family follow Terry to the kitchen to ask her if she can hand them some money to pay for Big Mama medical expenses. At this point, Terry in full villain mode, she ain't going. Then she tried to take out Miles and Faith. I'm not condoning the actions of Faith and Miles, but let's not forget what Terry was on. Here's a recap, because a lot of people, since he stepped out of his marriage, they want to make it seem like Terry was an angel. But let's recap how she was treating these folks.
Oldest one, I am the responsible one. I'm the one who graduated from law school. You're the one that dropped out when you were 19. So what about your jealousy, Max?
I also can't go to see you perform tonight.
That's what you said last week and the week before. I'd really like you to come tonight.
You know, I'm swamped with work.
I'm thinking about pursuing my music full time.
Miles, it's a mistake. What are you gonna do this time? Run up Mama's credit? Or make her co-sign on a car and then you leave her with the note? Why don't you get arrested again and let Mama put up the house to post your bail?
God damn!
Yeah, Terry was cutting up during the movie. So, Big Mama wakes up out of the coma, but before I go any further, I want to address something with Hollywood. As y'all can see, Big Mama is laying there with a nasal cannula on, and the nasal cannula is on the wrong way. It's supposed to be looped around her ears and then tied up underneath her chin. But Big Mama comes out of the coma, and she's awake for about a few minutes before she ends up passing away. After Big Mama's funeral, Maxine finds out that Terry had put up Big Mama's house for sale. Then Uncle P comes downstairs and he thinks Maxine is Big Mama. Maxine looking like we really had Uncle Pete upstairs only serving him food and not checking in on him and he got dementia. Maxine and Bird met with Terry to tell her that they had blocked her from selling the house. She was salty, so she ended up getting up and leaving. Then we find out that Bird is pregnant. She says Lim. I still think it's a toss-up between Lim or her ex. We still don't know the favor that she did for that job. Then Ahmad started tricking everybody to come to Sunday dinner. He had told them that it was like a secret stash of money that Big Mama had gave him, and that, you know, when they come to Sunday dinner, he was going to give them some of it. Then Terry made some phone calls and pulled some strings to get Lim out of jail, even though she the one who got him in there. So everybody started showing up to the house one by one for Sunday dinner. So everybody's sitting at the table getting ready to eat. Lim tells everybody that he got his job back, so he's excited about that. But then he ends up finding out that Bird is pregnant. He thinks the baby is his. I suggest he take a DNA test because it might be his boss's, the guy he about to work for again. And then Terry was just trying to start stuff with everybody. She was trying to start stuff with Miles. She was trying to start stuff with Faith. She was trying to start things with Bird. But, you know, everybody got it together. And then this happened. Then the fire had started in the kitchen. And then when the fire was going on, Uncle P had came downstairs. It's like he was holding a TV in his hand. That had dropped out of his hand. The next thing you know, you see a big bag of money. And from the looks of things, it was a happy ending. And I want everybody to look at Terry's face. This is the happiest I done seen her throughout this entire movie.
And even though we all miss Big Mama's cooking, laughter and love, none of us feel like life cheated or none. She accomplished everything she set out to do. Built a strong family with a rich tradition and to leave love in her footprints. Thanks.
To my mama. Sometimes I think that I ain't say thanks enough, but I always try to show it in my actions. I know you're not down here physically, but I still can feel your presence spiritually. But that don't mean we don't miss you down here. But I'm thankful for the 33 years that God gave me with you, because God could have gave me 100 years with you and that still wouldn't have been enough time. But thank you for being who you were when you was down here, because it made me the man that I am today. But yeah, man, we ain't about to keep listening to the sad music, because I know you somewhere singing, and I'm about to drop a song that y'all feel like you put on my mind today. Yeah, man, I can't play the whole song. But for those who's listening, that's Deion Ferris, Hopeless. But we're going to take a listen to this part right here, the instrumental. Let's go. thank y'all for watching. Until next time.